how the banking system works, how we got to where we got in 2008, and even better, what the road out of this is. You got to take a look at this book, A Miracle in Waiting, Economics That Makes Sense, and a lot of it has to do with the money supply. And everybody be well advised. Do some thinking about it. Never forget, originally, money, as we understand it, came from the people who dug it out of the ground in the form of gold. A lot has changed, and the man that we're talking to today well understands it. When we come back, Rick from Manitic and Peter from Orleans are going to get a chance to speak with Mr. Hellyer. If you want to get in on the conversation here on Michael Harris Live, the numbers are 521-8255, star 580 on the Bell Mobility System, and if you're calling from out of town or out of the country, 1-800-580-2372. We'll be right back with Paul Hellyer, and I hope you too. Good afternoon, folks. Welcome back to the program. We are talking to a very famous Canadian today, Paul Hellyer, about his new book, A Miracle in Waiting, Economics That Makes Sense. The book came out earlier in 1996, I believe, Paul, and you were one of the first people to predict the collapse of the near collapse of the system in 2008.
That's correct, yes.
We're going to take a call from Rick in Manitic, who would like to speak to you. Rick, welcome to the program.
Thanks, Michael. As usual, you always have great guests on, and Mr. Hellyer is no exception. He's a great Canadian, and I do own four of his books. I'm embarrassed to say that I haven't read them yet, but I did have the opportunity to hear Paul speak several years back when he had the Canadian Action Party rolling. And when I saw him, he was selling his books, and that's when I bought the four books, so I was very impressed. And hearing him again, it brings that all back to memory, and it causes me to say that these lists have to be high on my priority to read, as well as his new ones sound very interesting. He's certainly a thoughtful Canadian, and I know that he represented the area of Davenport, and I was fortunate enough to know Charles Catsey, who passed away a couple of years ago, unfortunately, and he was another great, what I like to call, public mentors that are out there.
That we have few of left in the country.
Absolutely, it's just great to have the opportunity to hear these people, to have the opportunity to listen to them. Some of their ideas and the way they explain the way things work are just great, because I'm not a highly educated guy, and I try to read a lot, and he's able to explain it so all of us can understand what he's talking about, and he doesn't have an agenda except to put his word out there, and it's great to see. A lot of them, a lot of people, it's because they're interested in going in politics or they have some reason, but he certainly strikes me as a person. He's just, likes to speak about what he believes in, and it's as simple as that. And anyways, thank you very much. I don't have any question for him other than saying it's great to see that he's still so active at 87. I'm 58, and I don't have half the energy he has, and it's great to hear him and to know that he's still around. So that's all I wanted to say.
Rick, thank you for your call. We're going to take a call from Peter in Orleans, who does have a question. Peter, what would you like to ask Paul Hellyer?
Good afternoon, Michael. Yes, I have a
good
question.
Good afternoon.
I have a question for Paul Hellyer.
Yes.
I am one of these Canadians whose eyes glaze over when we talk about financial matters. My question concerns the Canadian military. What I'd like to know, Americans look after their own. There's a lot of jobs that Americans get in, looking after their military. I don't think Canadians get very many jobs. I'm tired of hearing about submarines that don't surface. Where are the Canadian jobs for Canadian military?
Well, the fact is there are not enough jobs to go around at the moment for anything, including the military. The military has been starved for funds for 30 years, and as a result, they still have some of the equipment that I bought 40 years ago, which is ridiculous. You know, things, planes that were worn out 10 or 15 or 20 years ago, and helicopters, and they just have been starved. This is a tragedy in that if you have such wonderful forces as we have, that you don't give them the equipment that they really need to do the job. Part of the problem, though, is the one we're talking about, and whether eyes glaze over or not, it's the financial system, which has been partly, I would even say, predominantly responsible for the fact that there hasn't been enough money to do all of the other things that we want to do and still buy the equipment that is essential and fundamental for the jobs that we've given our military to do. Let me just take a minute or two and finish off what I was starting to say before the break, that we had this system from 1939 to 1974 where the money creation function was shared between the government of Canada and the private banks, and it worked well. It gave us the best 25 years of the 20th century. And in 1974, the central banks of the world, including the Bank of Canada, adopted the ideas of Milton Friedman. And it's been downhill ever since. And one of the things that has resulted from that change and the adoption of Milton Friedman's ideas was that they abandoned the requirement for banks to have cash reserves. In other words, banks were no longer required to have so much cash in their vaults or on deposit for the Bank of Canada for every dollar of deposits they had.
And it used to be gold that they used to, issue receipts on.
Yeah, way back.
Yeah.
But when I was young, they had a cash requirement in Canada of eight. Well, let me, if you give me a minute or two, just
yeah. Go ahead.
Back at the time that the Bank of England was chartered 300 years ago, the king, in order to show his appreciation for the fact that the bank raised money and lent it all to him at high interest rates, said you can print, P-R-I-N-T, an equal amount in banknotes and lend it to your friends at high interest rates, which they did.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that was what we call a leverage of 2-to-1. And then in the early years of the 20th century, federally chartered U.S. banks had to have 25% gold reserve in their vaults, which means that they could lend the same money 4 times.
Yes.
And then, I have already said, in the early days in Canada, our banks had to have an 8% cash reserve, so they could lend the same money 12.5 times. And then, as Michael has already said, now, however, under this new system, which we really adopted wholesale in 1991 when Mr. Mulroney and Mike Wilson changed the Bank Act, they no longer need cash reserves of any kind, zero, and you're lucky if your bank has a cent or a cent and a half in legal tender for every dollar you think you have in the bank. And now the leverage is 20-to-1, which in my opinion is just nothing but legalized fraud.
Paul, is that what led you to the great phrase that the counterfeiters learn to forge the receipts?
Well, this goes way back. It's a long story, and I don't think we've got time to go into it in a lot of detail today. If anybody's interested in sort of the history of money, they can get a copy of the book and take a look. But it's what it's doing to the world, in that we're not doing what we should be doing, and that's to follow what I call the Canadian precedent, reducing that bank leverage from 20-to-1 to say 3-to-1.
Yeah.
And giving the government back the right, it taking it back its own right, because it owns the patent to create money, and to create 30% or 33% of the money and balance its budget and stimulate the economy, get people back to work, buy equipment for whatever is needed, replace old infrastructure, do all the things that have to be done, instead of having so many people unemployed and factories operating at far, far less below potential.
We're going to take a short break here. We're going to come back with Paul Hellyer, and he's talking about his new book, A Miracle in Waiting, Economics That Makes Sense. It's about how we got to the point of 2008. We're going to be talking to Nick in Ottawa, who has a question for Paul. And I'm going to be making the observation that almost all the new money that's getting created is in the form of debt. And I have a hard time looking at massive, massive trillion-dollar deficits in the United States, believing that there is ever a way we could redeem that debt or pay it off. So at what point does this giant Ponzi scheme collapse in upon itself with all the new money being created as debt? I'm going to ask Paul Hellyer for his opinion on that. We'll be right back here on Michael Harris Live. Please stay with us if you can.